All right, what's up, guys? Back with another little kind of concept art style tutorial. This is for digital painting again. And this is kind of like piggybacking. This painting that I made is piggybacking off of the last video that I made where I recreated this like old drawing that I made in elementary school. And it was like this anglerfish man monster thing. And that just kind of inspired me to make a few more drawings of like, I don't know, kind of deep sea type creatures or just like sea creatures mixed with like humanoid like things and make these big monster stuff. So I decided I wanted to make one based off of a starfish because I kind of want to go through and do some more of the, I don't know, iconic sea creatures like starfishes and octopuses and stuff like that, sharks. So if you want to check out that video, you can. And so when I started this off, I just blocked in some colors for background, and then I started the sketching process. And I wanted to make like a starfish that was mixed with like a bear or something. So I originally played around with the sketch a lot to get some kind of, I don't know, get the proportions and everything to look right. And I think it's very important to get your sketches looking correct, like looking the way that you want them right off the bat. Like if you're not excited about how your sketch looks, then you should probably redo it or rework something until you get really excited to paint the rest of it. So yeah, here I'm just going through and trying to rework the sketch as many times as it needs to get something that I'm really excited about. And I was using references for this. I looked at a lot of pictures of bears kind of standing up and roaring. I looked at different concept art of different starfish monster type things. And I also just looked at pictures of starfishes too in general. One thing to note when you're coming up with an idea for a concept art character monster is that make it something that's a bit more interesting or a bit more dynamic than like what you would first think. So instead of just like, I'm going to draw a goblin, think of something, I don't know, more interesting to kind of add to that. Like what type of landscape would it be in? Maybe it's a goblin mixed with something else. That's something that's like not, that hasn't been done before. So this is why I wanted to, you know, combine the starfish with the bear, you know, because I don't think I've seen that before, and I thought it was something interesting. And so here I was kind of coming up with the concept. I wanted it to have this skull coming out of the center of like the star, because like the almost as if the starfish's arms on his chest are like his mouth. So it opens up and the skull is right in the middle. Like where the normal mouth of a starfish would be right in the center of the starfish. So I kind of ended up designing it so that it has some eyes on its shoulders, almost as if it's like a false kind of face, or there's some barnacles on his shoulders. I ended up getting rid of them later because once I paint them, it becomes a bit too cluttered in the painting, but for the time being, my idea with this is that it's like when it's closed up, you wouldn't see this kind of horrifying skull head inside of it. But then when it goes in to attack you or something, it would open up, and you'd see this horrifying dead-eyed skull monster come out of it. Now, what I'm doing right here is making sure to flip the character back and forth a lot, like reflecting the canvas, because there's a lot of times where you'll start working on something and you'll get so used to how it looks that there can be something off with its proportions or its the way it's composed, basically. And if you don't flip it back and forth, then those issues will kind of stay in the painting and go unnoticed. But if you reflect it, then you'll realize immediately what looks off. So I'll usually reflect it, work on it for a bit, then reflect it back, keep working on it. That way it just all evenly kind of comes to fruition. And here I also tried to make the anatomy as kind of similar to a man, as if it was a giant buff man, as I could. But obviously anatomy is not the most important part thing when you're creating like a monster concept. Besides the bear claws, it ended up actually not looking all that much like a bear. But it was fine in the end because I still very much enjoyed the kind of concept that I was going for, and I thought it really worked. The way that it was, like, this is supposed to be some huge hulking lumbering giant that also happens to be a starfish, which is, I don't know, just interesting. It's something that I haven't seen very often before. So always try to kind of come up with creative ideas that'll help your monster concepts, that just stuff that hasn't been seen before, stuff that grabs people's eye. Here I'm thinking about lighting very early on because it's good to sculpt your painting kind of based off of the lighting. So I like block in some really strong backlighting, and actually the entirety of this painting ends up being like a really dark painting with a really strong backlight to get that intense contrast. So yeah, just always think about lighting. Lighting is very important in paintings, and it'll kind of make the difference between a painting that really catches your eye and like sells you, and some kind of mediocre painting. Like it really makes the difference between those night and day. So here my initial lighting setup is a kind of soft light, a very warm soft light coming from in front of him, over the top, so you can see like the top planes of his head and his muscles and everything are glowing a bit more, and then also a very strong backlight from the backside. But then I end up actually changing this. I get rid of his front light so that he's only lit by the backlight, and then I add glow to his eyes so that his eyes kind of illuminate his teeth and his tongue a little bit, but not much more than that. And from this point on, it's pretty much just a steady phase of refining. My brush size slowly gets smaller and smaller as I add more details to things, until it starts to get to a spot where I really see the whole thing in its scope. Now there's a point in painting when you want to make sure your values are right. So like at this stage in the painting, when I zoom out, I mean, I see exactly what the monster is. I see exactly what it's supposed to be. And this in itself does work as a concept. But I'm just going further into the painting because I want to add more detail and I want to flesh it out a bit. I also like to use a lot of different colors just very subtly, even if like this monster is fairly monochromatic. He's just kind of a red, like a dark red. But as I go in, I'll add tints of green into him, tints of like purple and gold, just very subtle stuff. This is actually a very strong green tint on over his head and back right now that I get rid of and tweak. But just stuff like that is what really helps to make it look like it's a real kind of texture of a character, like something that you can reach out and grab something that's been weathered by the elements, as opposed to just a, I don't know, kind of fake rendered painting, like a, I don't know, just like a computer generated one color. If you kind of think, if you ever use like a 3D modeling software, seeing somebody use it kind of just reminds me of like some mesh that, you know, is plopped into the engine, and then you put one solid color over it, and it just looks fake. It looks plastic in a way. I hear him kind of tweaking up the teeth, and make sure that when you're painting, like, teeth of a character like this, that you don't just make them white. Like, I added pink and yellow on top of it to kind of make them look like they're, you know, a bit more decayed or dirty, or like they've been bloodied by eating something. And now, I actually think that this background really sells the image, because I tried to really kind of portray how the light is hitting the character. In a way that also like reflects on the background, so you see the light on the floor is super intense, because that's like the backlight that's like washing over, and then there's a big shadow where he is, and I even go in and put a little shadow under his legs because some light would seep through there, so it really makes him look like he exists in this space. Now I'm tweaking the backlighting a little bit, and actually at this point, this is when I decide to get rid of the light that's presumably right in front or on top of him. So I change it so that the light kind of wraps around him more from the backlighting. That's also a good idea when you're tweaking your values and everything, to every once in a while set your painting to black and white. Because if once you set it to black and white, if you can still tell where all the shapes are and everything, if it all still looks right, then you'll know that you're good. But if not, then you're gonna want to tweak stuff. So every once in a while, I'll, you know, shift it to black and white, as well as flipping the canvas around to make sure that the values and everything, values, composition, all that stuff, it gets kind of cemented. It just like, you constantly check your work in a way. I'm adding a glow to his eyes, and actually play around with how the lighting affects his face. So like here, he's got a big glow like right on his forehead, but I end up kind of changing that for a more subtle glow. And then my favorite like part, the way that how it reacts like off of his teeth, how the light reflects. I end up putting in highlights on his teeth, a little bit of a glow on his tongue. Just that really looks like that the light from his eyes is reacting to the rest of his face. Thank you. here I actually played around with rendering the eyes, like the kind of false eyes, as that he would look through if the skull wasn't kind of emerged from the starfish thing in the middle of him. Then I decided that since it's such high contrast at those two points as well, it does kind of take away from the focal point. So the first thing that you see when your eyes are drawn to is his eyes, like on the skull, because they're glowing and they're such high contrast. It's very bright right against a very dark, shadowy figure. And the false eyes did the same thing. So I felt like it just kind of spaced out the focal points in a really weird way. So I decided to paint over them and just kind of get rid of them because they weren't doing the painting anything more interesting. Maybe this kind of concept of the false eyes, like it reminds me of the basilisks in Dark Souls, because they got these big bulbous kind of huge eyes, but their real eyes are like these tiny little eyes that are actually on its head, like in front of the big ones. So yeah, maybe that's something else that I'll kind of explore in different iterations of this monster if I decide to do that. But for this painting, I decided to leave it out. So it's always important to kind of make sure you leave out things that aren't necessary, that kind of compromise the integrity of the painting. If you throw all your ideas at a painting and they just don't all work together, don't try to force them to work if they're not meant to. Another reason that I think the kind of glow on his teeth and tongue and eyes looks so well is because green and red, to an extent, are complementary colors. I think it's more technically like green and pink, or green and purple. Actually, it might be green and red, but they're very opposite on the color spectrum, so they're called complementary colors. Same for blue and orange, or I think yellow and purple. Although it's pretty hard to make yellow and purple work right, but blue and orange. Specifically, like, I think looked really good together if you use that in the right ways. And so for this, using the green as a complementary color to the red, it since they're such polar opposites, it makes the contrast really pop. So kind of learning little just tricks about color theory really helps paintings overall. Here's I'm adding up the final touch. I wanted to make the background kind of fit the other anglerfish man painting that I did. So I try to make it look a little more green, a little cooler in comparison to the red guy, because I thought it ended up looking like a demon, like he's in hell or something, like something from Doom, which he's a sea monster. So I wanted to change that. But yeah, here's the finished product. I hope you kind of learned something going through my process with these concept monsters. And that's it. Peace.